the big thing with me is mindfulness. It's just one of those like three M's where asking why is one of the most important questions you can ask yourself. Whether it's what you're eating, what you're doing, or what you're driving towards. Yeah.
It's kind of the foundation of consciousness in a way.
For real.
You know, when you realize, like, why am I here? Or not even realize, but when you just propose the ideas of, like, why am I here? What am I? You know, why is this happening? That's when you start to kind of wake up and realize that you have the opportunity to, you know, cause a lot of effect and change in the world. And hopefully it's for the better.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's really empowering when you start to ask yourself that.
What's up, everyone? Nate Sarantino here, back with another episode of the Free Thinkers Emergence Podcast. And today with me is my good friend and my partner in business, John Gaffney.
What's up, everybody?
So, John, you just got back from Connecticut. How was your weekend?
Yeah, it was a great weekend. I got to spend most of the weekend with like my oldest friend. Both our moms grew up friends in their childhood homes in Connecticut, and now we've been pretty much friends since birth.
Nice.
So, yeah, it's my boy. Shout out to Matt.
I love
that. We had a lot of fun. Went to some breweries, played some golf, went on a hike. It was a lot of fun. And then I got to spend the last day with my grandmother, so that was great too.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. I'm glad I saw you on Saturday before you left, and so I'm glad that you got to spend a great couple of days with the boys and the grandma.
Yeah,
anyways, we got an important topic to talk about here today, and that's leadership and team building and really how to network in the form of building a team and what it takes to have a really powerful team, an impactful team, a team that can present a lot of value to the world around them. I'll let you start it off.
Totally. Well, I spent a lot of the ride home today listening to some podcasts and some YouTube videos pertaining a lot to this topic. So I guess one of the first things that I'll dive into that I pulled away from it was looking at different ways to interpret the game of business. One of the things that this guy, Simon Sinek, kept bringing up, which really resonated with me and really just my perception of how I see people operating their business, was playing the game of business either as a finite game, like within a parameter of rules, or like with the objective of like having a win at the end of this finite game versus playing the infinite game. And the example he used for like a finite game was like a game of baseball, you know, how you have a set of parameters and rules, and then at the end of the game, whoever has the most runs is pretty clearly the winner.
Mm-hmm.
Versus the infinite game. And the first example that really resonated that he proposed was like Apple, the company Apple Computers, because they don't try to find like wins within their company or within their product. Instead, they're playing this game of always adapting to the consumer's needs and putting out something that's going to stand the test of time.
Wow. I have never heard that before about the finite. I've heard of it. I've never really dove into it. I think I've gotten a glimpse of this from Andy Frisella talking about it on his podcast, Real AF. And the infinite game for me is most definitely my game of business, and it's been my whole life has been geared towards this long-term plan, like 5, 10, 15, 20 years. Like, I don't really plan in like months. I've never done that. It's not my thing. And the idea of building a team that you can work with for the long term, where you all have a vision or a goal in mind, but the goal isn't finite. It's a goal.
It's a vision. It opens up doorways to all these other possibilities.
Exactly.
If anything, versus the idea of like someone who goes to college and they get a degree in a particular area and their end goal is like, oh, if I go and I get this document, then I'll find the perfect job. And that's sort of like the win, the finite game
that
many people will play. And you can relate that to whatever it is. It doesn't need to be finding a job. It could be like finding a relationship if you're trying to find love. But like we all know, and I think Simon made a good point about this in his videos, you don't win love. It's a ever-flowing, you know, sequence that people have to work on for as long as they're alive. You don't just fall in love and then love is there. It never stops growing. You always have to work on it. And that's the same way that I think is important to approach any business, is you don't just find a perfect product or a perfect service and do that. You always have to be evolving, and it's going to depend on whatever the business is. So if you're trying to make some kind of product, but you're just focused on making this one product, you could be missing out on opportunities in so many other areas. You know, maybe there's another product, or maybe there's a way that you could be using your product in a way that you hadn't initially thought of. I mean, it's always evolving. I think that's what makes, you know, a really solid leader, is someone who can identify all the different possibilities and find, you know, different visions for a particular entity. And beyond that, identifying the people in the company, their strengths and weaknesses, and inspiring them and getting them to understand their own potential, instead of like nitpicking and directing them like a manager would. They inspire and they incite people to want to be better.
Yeah. Wow. A lot to unpack. Inspiring people to change themselves is very important. Inspiring people to go after a vision is even more important. That's how movements are created, and the idea of a movement is you have a message that resonates with other people. So you have a business, you talked about there's so many different ways you can adapt, whether it's a product or a service, and you're gonna wanna pick the best path, not for only you, but for everyone. And when you own a business, you're working for the consumer of whatever you are producing or servicing, and it's really important to get your teammates on the same wavelength that is whatever vision you're going after, whatever that goal or movement you're trying to create. You want to be able to instill that vision upon everyone. I've talked to a lot of people about my vision of having a psychedelic therapy company, specifically with psilocybin, and more importantly about this mushrooms as a whole. And I just want to have a nonprofit that we all can work towards building a better humanity using the many capabilities of mushrooms, like psychedelics, as well as all the other adaptogenic mushrooms. There's so much potential in them, and it's all about like painting pictures and selling situations to people and show them, wow, like if this was the world, this would be great. And they say, yeah, it would be, but how do we get there? And then that's how you show them how to get there.
I think that's definitely one way that some people, like if you're trying to lead a community of people, that's how some people could interpret it, for sure. And I think that that's a really effective way to lead a strong company. But I've interpreted almost in the sense that, like, if you want someone to truly have a passion and an inspiration behind what they're doing, it almost makes sense to ask themselves why they do it more than anything. I think the question why is super undervalued. And if you can keep asking why, and like every time you answer a question for yourself or whatever it may be, you ask why even further. And, you know, why am I doing this? Oh, this is why I'm doing this. But why? And just keep picking it apart until you can get to that root. That's how people will really find a true passion and a purpose for whatever it is. So you might be able to spell out a vision for a company, but that might not align with every person who you're working with. So I think if they can, they don't, you know, that's why it's important to like be flexible with whoever you're working with. You know, maybe someone's not the right fit, and that doesn't mean it's a bad thing, but you know, not everything's meant to be in that way. But if you can find people who agree on the same ethos and the same why, that's when you can make a really successful, you know, team.
Yeah.
And help get a lot accomplished.
I agree 100%. The big thing with me is mindfulness. It's just one of those like 3 M's where asking why is one of the most important questions you can ask yourself. Whether it's what you're eating, what you're doing, or what you're driving towards.
Yeah. It's kind of the foundation of consciousness in a way.
For real.
You know, when you realize, like, why am I here? Or not even realize, but when you just propose the ideas of, like, why am I here? What am I? You know, why is this happening? That's when you start to kind of wake up and realize that you have the opportunity to, you know, cause a lot of effect and change in the world. And hopefully it's for the better.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's really empowering when you start to ask yourself that.
100%. The question why brings you to the highest level of consciousness, which is like, which is you do things because they feel right, and that's being authentic. Authenticity is the highest vibration, and then you realize, okay, this is just me. Like, this is what I care about, and no one taught me to care about these things. I just care about this because... Well,
I was going to say, can I almost, like, flip the script and interview you for a minute? Like, why do you do this? What got you started in this, like, mindfulness and like self-empowerment sort of journey?
Because I was that kid who just didn't care. Like, literally, like... could give less than a fuck about anything. I played hockey growing up, and I cared about it. Like, I put a lot of effort and energy into it. My parents did, and I did, and it was fun. But, and this is a big but, when it came to freshman or even 8th grade into freshman year, I started vaping. I was like, wow, this is cool. And I love smoke. I'm a pyromaniac. I love smoke. I love fire. So vaping was awesome. And then I started getting into smoking weed. And I was like, wow, this is even more awesome. And I started to let go of hockey as much. And I started to lose everything. Not just people, but myself. When you get consumed by the consumption, sounds weird putting it that way, but that's the majority of today's society is consumers. And when you consume so much, you've now consumed your authenticity, you lose that. Why am I doing this? And it's more, I am doing this. And I never once stopped to ask myself why I was smoking weed more than the first times. Why should I try this? Oh, it's cool. And then I liked the feeling, and I just chased that feeling until I was on my deathbed. Whether it was the nicotine buzz and the Juul, or the smoke tricks with the box mods, or the see how high I can get with dab carts. It was all this addiction and chasing feelings. The feelings that don't last because they're induced from substances instead of induced by actions that you get just by doing stuff. So you asked, why did I start this podcast? Why did I get onto this mindfulness route? Why did I get into this empowerment? Because I was lost once, and then I found myself. I had help finding myself, but I found myself nonetheless. And I realized I can help other people find their authentic selves. I can help them be grateful just for life itself. I can help them align with their beliefs. I can help them figure out what love means to them. And those are the four highest vibrations, and that's how you start to create change in yourself. And once you change yourself, you are changing the world. So it all just goes back to, why did I do this? Figured out why I did it through reflection with the use of psilocybin, which opened up my eyes to just being grateful for being alive with anything, with nothing. Just, you're alive, life is a gift. And then we moved forward into, okay, let's drop the vape. Okay, let's drop the weed. Okay, let's just go sober completely. And then I was at UVM starting my company on fitness and nutrition. It was Save Your Services or Save Your Fitness and Wellness. It's a play on words for saving your own life through good nutrition and good exercise. Mm. That was where the name came from. And now it's turned into teaching people how to save themselves, inspiring people to want to help themselves in a world where everyone feels so helpless because of that consumption. They're stuck. Mm-hmm. In an endless cycle,
yeah.
Literally.
Or chasing a thing that doesn't truly exist.
For real, bro.
Like one of those more like a finite game.
Mm-hmm. Everyone's obsessed with the idea of winning. But yeah, what does it even totally. Mean to
right.
win?
What is it going to get you in the long run?
Yeah.
What happens after you win? I think a lot of like professional athletes face that. They'll like be on the top of their career, like on top of the world after winning a championship, and it seems like a lot of them kind of spiral after that, because it's like, now what? If your total purpose in life is just to have like that one moment, then what happens after that? So
yeah, 100%
what finding your higher purpose is all about. And I think that's dope that you want to like inspire change in the world by giving people self-empowerment, you know, the power to reflect and to critique themselves and want to be better.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So let me ask you.
Sure.
What's your biggest why these days? What's the thing? You have a company. Can I bring it up?
Yeah.
So John has a company called Element of Surprise.
Mm-hmm.
What inspired you to create this company and why do you do it?
Yeah, I mean, so many things, it's hard to wrap up into just a brief summary, because I feel like it's kind of an accumulation of so many things throughout my entire life that have kind of gotten me to this idea. But I guess the long and short is just wanting to, you know, in the most simple way I can put it, just give people a fun experience that they'll remember, that they can kind of forget about the hard, you know, difficult moments of life and just be able to like get loose and like break free from that cycle.
Yeah.
So I, at the end of the day, I suppose my company is an entertainment company. Like I want people to, you know, have fun, be entertained, be enthralled by it, and get to participate in these really unique experiences. Just to give some background on my company, I won't go too into detail because I'm, you know, I'm still really early on and I don't want to give it all out there, but like basically we put together some really unique experiences for our guests. Each one is going to be really uniquely tailored. Each one's going to be one of a kind. And it's going to involve things like teamwork. They're going to have to work with their friends and even strangers out in real life to accomplish certain tasks, maybe go on like, you know, little adventures together. So my why is to really inspire people to just go try something new, to have fun, to relax and just let go. So, and for me, it's also been an opportunity to take all these different things that I love throughout my life. Cause like I said, each experience is going to be unique. So I can take all these things that I've experienced in my own life or that I've seen other people do, and I can make that a part of this journey, and kind of share that with other people in a way, and also help to bring in ideas from people who had a different experience than me.
I love that.
Yeah.
I think it's really important. There's one of the most important things when it comes to public speaking and communication as a whole is people don't remember what you said. They remember how you made them feel. Mm-hmm. And the same goes for events. The reason people have memories is because their feelings, the feeling of doing X, Y, and Z was so-and-so. And now you have these feelings and they get stored. And these are like, people don't chase the memories, they chase the feelings. So I think that might be a big help with your company is get people attached to feelings.
I guess that's definitely true in a way. But I do hope people resonate more with the memory.
They will.
Of the fact that like they get to participate in this with people they love, like whether that be a friend or a family member or could be a total stranger that they kind of meet in the whole process.
Mm-hmm.
Ultimately, that's what I would like to see from this adventure.
100%.
Is people making like genuine, authentic connection, human to human connection, because that's the most important thing that we have is each other.
I agree.
So that's what I'd like to inspire with this company. And it should be a really, really fun process.
Yeah, building community is really important, and it all goes back to like this networking and team building, and whether you're building the community through something like what you're doing or something like what I'm doing, we're both building people up,
mm-hmm.
and we're building individuals up to work together, and then those teams work with other teams, and this is how humanity prospers and becomes the highest version of itself.
Yeah, for sure.
We need more people to put in the work on themselves to actually be able to create the change in society. I stand by this, and I'm gonna die by this. You can't change the world, you can only change yourself. And mm-hmm. by changing yourself, you then change you can the make world. An
impact. Yeah. I completely agree. Yeah. I used to want to do a lot of different things relating to, you know, repairing the world. And I've always related it to like growing up, going to a Jewish summer camp is called Tikkun Olam, which literally means to repair the world.
It's beautiful.
And so that's something that I've always kind of had in my mind is like, how can I use what I'm doing to make a real impact? So, you know, I thought maybe that was just to go around and like, I don't know, pick up trash or to, I don't know, find some way that has an immediate result that's clearly, you know, tangible that shows that I was changing the world. And so I did some of those things, which is nice. And, you know, that's cool. But it's a really small impact. I think it's important for me, at least, to have like a big ripple where I can inspire other people to want to make the world better. And I think that's kind of how you see it as well.
It resonates hard.
Yeah. And so if I can, like we just talked about, if you can change yourself and like how you go about your business or your day or how you treat people, you can send ripples into the ether.
Yeah, for real. Dude, everything you speak, words are so incredibly powerful, and we're creating movements even just with our thoughts. Like, everything is like resonance and it going out. So, like, the whole point of saying it resonates is you say something, it hits me. I'm like, wow, that sounds so great. I'm going to say the same thing. That is resonance.
For sure. That and guy who I was watching today had a big impact on what I opened up with this podcast on, the way that he inspired me to want to inspire the people who I'm guiding as a leader for my company. You know, and I think he's probably had that impact on, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of leaders in many different realms, whether that's in business or in some sort of community or you name it, a summer camp, it could be anything.
Yeah.
So that would be a dream come true, is to just have like that kind of an impact where you make people want to be better.
100%. It's really important and really love where this is headed. Team building, inspiration, inspiring people. Know what, one of our, so me and John are both really good friends with Breno. You both have heard, or you all have heard me talk about him. And the other day, Breno gave me this compliment. He told me how good I am at inspiring other people to be of service to others. And I was talking to one of my clients last night, and I was telling him, everything you do should be in service to other people. If you always put other people first in a way where you're not only this dumping energy, but you're adding to the point where it's going to be adding back to you too. But excuse me, your intention should be to be of service. Intentions are the karmic cycle. Cause and effect are the actions. Any thoughts?
You. It's a lot to take in.
It is. It's deep.
Yeah.
I've taken so much in lately. I've been listening to a lot on public speaking, getting better with personal excellence all around. Someone I study a lot these days is Tony Robbins.
I'm not really familiar with Tony Robbins.
The easiest way to put it is he is really good at moving people in a positive direction through his teachings. He's a public speaker, and he also is into philanthropy as well as all these other things. But the big thing is his main thing is personal excellence, being of service to other people, and actually like putting your all into the things you do and seeing how you can create change when you really put your all into yourself and then into the things that you care about.
So you're saying that in a way, the more you can self-improve, the more you'll be of service to the world?
Exactly, because you create innate value. It's where if you know how to sell, you can go to any business with any product or service and sell that. And that's the game of life. Everything comes down to sales and marketing. You market yourself and then you sell yourself. You market your skills and then you sell them. And this is how we, as entrepreneurs, create value for other people through convincing them and persuading them that you need what I have to survive. Like, you can't make it without this. That's how you can convince someone that if they'll die if they don't do this, and they won't live to the fullest if they don't do this.
So that doesn't necessarily sound like it's of service. That sounds like it's of...
But it's not. It is at the point where when you need to better yourself, if you're not growing, you're dying. If you're not adding, you're subtracting. Energy is always moving.
Let's go back to what you mentioned a minute ago. So if your purpose is to make someone feel that if they don't have a particular service or thing, that they're life is not as good, that seems like it could cause a lot of detriment to society. Like for example, like the most recent pop culture fad I can think of that pertains to that is the Stanley mugs, like those big, you know, water bottles that all the kids have. And I think a lot of people felt that they needed to have those mugs, and the kids who didn't have them almost were treated like a lower class. Not even just kids. I think I've seen it with a lot of adults being like, oh, that's not a real Stanley mug. Like,
that's wild. That's so crazy because you're right.
And so that's not the kind of product or service that I want to have. I want to have a product or service that people choose to use or to be a part of because it truly is breaking that barrier. It's actually going to uplift people and unite people and give people a purpose. And not only just a purpose, but like a point of connection. Because I think that's one of our greatest purposes is to connect with other people and inspire. So rather than try to sell something based on like an impulse or like a dire need or like a quick hit of dopamine when getting that product, I want to make an impact in a lasting fashion. So like we talked about before, like having an experience where the memory isn't just of the experience, it's actually the connection and the opportunity that experience presented to make bonds with other people or to learn something new about a destination or whatever it may be. I think those are the kind of products and services that in the long run have the greatest success. And then I'll relate it back to Apple computers one more time. They weren't just going for like a win, like the coolest, device of the year, which oftentimes they do have arguably maybe the coolest device of whatever, but that's besides the point. They actually have fostered a culture that's connected people, whether it be their messaging services or the way that they've allowed people to share their music, you name it. They've created an entire culture that connects through their company. And they've created a great workplace culture too. Like we see a lot of people talking about how great it is to work for Apple, so much to the point where some people don't even really leave the campus. Like they have homes right next to the campus. They work out there. They eat food there. They want to spend time at that place because it's driving a higher purpose for them.
Very true. People, I have an iPhone. This is specifically on the Apple thing. And it goes hand in hand with the Stanley mug analogy you made earlier. I have an iPhone, but I have iMessage turned off. People will say, why are your messages green? What, do you have an Android or something? And in a way that's like derogatory towards Androids. Mm-hmm. Where, so even, there's always going to be a...
There's going to be a byproduct.
There always is.
For sure. Right, and I actually expect, I've thought about this quite a lot, and I think there's going to be a major byproduct with my company as well, because some people may not have the opportunity to participate in all these things.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to feel a little bit exclusive in a way, because we can only, the opportunity can only be available to so many people.
There's value in exclusivity, though.
For sure. So it's a double-edged sword, right? Mm-hmm. That's I feel like that's kind of where you're heading with this.
100%, because going back to what I said earlier about... a comparison of life and death, where I really do bring everything to life and death in my head, just for the sake of the argument. It makes every decision pretty easy. If you do this, you die. If you do this, you live. So you don't need to think too hard after that. And so
that's extreme.
It is, bro. It's about as black and white as it gets. And so I've come to these thoughts, and this is just from when the more you ask why, the more you go to extremes, because you realize the only gray area is the area you don't define, and if you define everything for yourself, then there is no gray area, because everything becomes black and white.
That's just an illusion. You can't. There's nothing. There's no situation where you know everything.
Well, yeah, but you can define all the things that you know. And then everything you don't know is this, it's black. It's black until it's white.
Mm.
It's you don't know what you don't know, and that's unconscious incompetence. Or conscious incompetence.
Mm-hmm.
Where you're just like, I can sell, but I'm not good at selling. I'm consciously incompetent at sales to a certain degree. I'm not by any means the best closer in the world, but like I could convince someone that they're gonna live longer if they do something, and they're gonna die if they do something.
Mm.
And that's where do you draw the line between telling someone the truth versus telling someone that they need something even though they don't? It's like the Stanley mug or the iPad. I've had this brick of a laptop for so long. The battery lasts like an hour. I had a MacBook at UVM. I fell while on my scooter, smashed a kombucha bottle, destroyed everything in my bag. It was tragic. Lost this like $1,500 MacBook. And I had just gotten it like a year before. And these people in one of my church groups from Chi Alpha, thank you to Daniela and Isaac, if you guys do listen to this, they gave me a laptop for free. They had just gotten, it was just like sitting at their house, and they were like, Nate, you can have this. We don't really use it. I was just like, thank you so much. Went to go give it back at the end of the semester. They said, no, we don't need it back.
Wow, that's pretty nice of them.
It is very nice of them. Now, it was great for the time I had it. Now that I'm going away, no one knows where I'm moving yet. I'm still keeping it a secret, okay. But they know that I'm moving. Okay. So, anyways, by the
He's
time...
moving to South Korea.
By the time this is released, I should already be left, because this is going to be cute. Oh, no, this will come out on October 29th.
All right.
Anyways, so, the laptop, it's good. It works. It does the job. But it has a lot of kinks. A lot of kinks. So, I'm about to sell my PC to my friend. I'm going to sell a bunch of stuff before I move. And I'm going to go buy myself a MacBook Pro so I have something while I'm on the road. And why am I getting a MacBook Pro? Because it is so good and so easy to use. Kind of like the iPhones. And then you realize you can't fake something that is actually excellent. Like, true level of excellence, whether it's in a person or a product or a service.
Oh, dude. Tell me about it. One of my favorite sayings at the moment is a Latin term, res ipsa. Also happens to be the name of one of my favorite clothing brands. You're welcome for the free plug. But anyways, res ipsa means the thing speaks for itself.
Wow. Wow.
You know, so if you have such a product or service that's so excellent that it speaks for itself, you're doing something right. When someone else does the marketing for you because you've actually impressed this person and made such an impact that they want to share it, like I just did with that company, like that's when you have a major impact. The thing speaks for itself. I don't have to tell you, Apple doesn't have to tell you what the new features are on their new MacBook. You don't even know what they are, but you just know that they have an excellent product that's user-friendly, that's interconnective. The thing speaks for itself. Everyone uses these products, and they clearly have had a lot of success with them. Therefore, the company is going to have success in selling them, and you're going to have success using their product.
I'm so glad you brought that up. That goes hand in hand with it is what it is, which is one of my favorite sayings, which good is as good is, excellent is as excellent is, and then everything underneath. That's it.
Yeah, the thing speaks for itself. I love that saying.
Wow. I'm so glad you brought that up.
Yeah, for sure.
It's always going to be like one of those things where it's like quality, quality, quality. One really, really good YouTube video versus a bunch of worse ones. That's why I'm only releasing one video per week now, because I'm editing these videos myself. I'm putting time into editing these. It took me some time to figure out how to edit. And then I had to do it to get better. So they had to be bad. And then they got better. And they're still not good. They're this okay now. Mm. But they're almost good. They're almost good. Once I get the intro from... I'm going to have someone make me an intro for these. Mm. And then we'll get good. I was talking to him about it on the phone the other night. My editor... he might be moving to the same place, bro. He got an offer from someone in his family who's moving out there. And dude, everyone's moving to the same place right now, bro. It's crazy. Oh my gosh. Yo. Oh my gosh. Well, it's good stuff.
I think the most important thing that you're doing is that you've done it. Like, you actually started your podcast. You had an idea and you actually made it work. And whether your resources were pretty limited or not, you executed it. Like, you didn't say, oh, I'm going to wait till I have a, you know, $30,000 setup with beautiful cameras and lighting and bullet mics and everything. You actually went out and you got stuff that was going to do the job, and you kept building it as you went. Like, you started with very few
materials. Yeah, I started with an iPhone 8.
Right. And all of a sudden you've built upon it. You have all this different equipment right here.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of one of the most important things is, like, if you don't actually do it, it's never going to happen. Like, you can try to perfect the idea all you want, but the best way to get feedback on your idea is to start doing the idea. And I got to give a major shout out to my friend Bernie, because I know he just started a podcast too. And he had a similar mindset going into that podcast that resonated with me. He's basically saying, like, if I don't need to have, like, the perfect, you know, equipment and all this and that, like, I just want to start making this podcast so I can start to spread a message. And he's been doing exactly that. He's been having some fantastic interviews with specifically lately pertaining to a lot of Israeli politics and culture, because that's where he lives at the moment. And it's been really cool to see, because he's been putting together a great show with finite resources.
I'm glad to hear that. Dude, it's hard. The thing I live by these days is, you can fail two ways. You can fail if you don't start, and you can fail if you quit.
Yeah. But with that said, I don't think quitting is always a bad thing. Sometimes you might, you know, realize that something's not working out. It's not necessarily quitting. I guess it's just understanding that, like,
this was not okay. Meant for me.
Yeah, it's okay to have, like, a new approach, or just to try something different. You know, if you feel like something's not right, it's okay to, like,
I took, you know, this,
swallow your pride and stop doing what you're doing to make a change.
Yeah, I took this term from Alex Hormozi.
There has to be, like, a reason.
To pivot. Mm. Like, you don't do something unless you want to do it. Unless you're being forced against your will. But even if you have to pivot, you might have to do a full 180, and that's the most you can pivot.
For sure.
It's like,
but you might not even realize, like, where you're pivoting. What I mean is that I think... Like, I'll use an example. One of my coworkers, she started doing, like, real estate courses, and it was going fine. Like, I think she was learning a lot, and she seemed mildly passionate about it. But as she kept going and getting closer to that test, she realized that, like, she didn't want to put any of her energy into this, and that it was draining her, and it wasn't really of interest or passion for her, and decided to quit, quote unquote, doing that. But I think... there's nothing wrong with that. If you can acknowledge that that's not going to work for you, and you decide to, like, pivot and find something else from that point, maybe you don't even know what the next step is. There's something kind of, I don't know, it's kind of noble to understand what you don't want and not do it just as much as it is to find what you do want.
That's why I stopped dating right there, is I figured out what I don't want, so now I'm just waiting till I find what I do want, and I'm not gonna go waste my time breaking girls' hearts because I don't want X, Y, and Z. I have to wait till I have myself set up now to go start dating again, because I'm at the point where I don't want to focus my energy on anyone but myself and the people I'm doing business with and building a team with. It's where that's, like, my stage of life, and it's just you choose what you put your energy into, and you go all in, and then the highest level is all in on the things you really care about and having such good balance that, like, the time management is precise. So, like, choosing what you want to do, when you want to do it, how you want to do it.
Yeah, I mean, that's a beautiful thing. That's also ties back to, like, your consciousness. If you can understand that, like, everything you do every day is a choice. You know, I think a lot of people wake up and they go to a job that they don't like. And, you know, I'm guilty of doing that for plenty of moments throughout my life. And sometimes you have to do that.
Doing that shit right now with flooring.
Yeah, you got to do what you got to do to make ends meet and to further other goals that are bigger outside of your job. But some people just continue to do the same thing day after day after day with no plan of action and how to change that. And that, to me, is a major bummer. So I think if people can, at the very least, like, ask themselves why they do what they do and, you know, try to just create a game plan. Like, you know, maybe you might have to keep that shitty job for another few months or years or whatnot. But, like, if you are always working on a plan, then that's the best you can do. It's just be mindful of what you're doing and how you're going to change if you choose to change.
Yeah, that's what you just said, like, the combination between planning and then doing is, like, the balance between masculine and feminine energy, where feminine's, like, a planning, nurturing kind of energy, and masculine's, like, active action kind of energy. And you need to have both. However, masculine will always be the dominant, because even if you spend your whole life planning, you're never going to get anything done. And then if you just spend your whole life doing, you might get something done, but you might just go down the wrong path the whole time.
Might miss a lot of opportunity.
You'll just be miserable. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of really great men who hate what they do, but they do it because they put themselves in that position, and now it's really hard to get out.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
Dude, the dollar bill corrupts the soul. If you don't have control over that, that's the highest level of control at this point in society. I mean, being able to control when you eat, when you drink, that's pretty tough. But it really comes down to what are you willing to do for a dollar bill so you can go get that food, or so you can go get the stuff so you can grow the food.
Mm.
You know? It's like, you need
it. Right, I think, that's definitely true. Comes down to that, and also, like, how you can possess your emotions to, like, make those rational decisions.
True.
Like, the more you can understand the way you think and, like, how you react to certain things, and you can be better prepared for those sort of situations, I think that's also a big part of it.
Yeah, dude, my boss hurt his shoulder really bad this morning. Like, bad. Like, the most pain I've ever seen this guy in. Immediately, like, a few hours later, he's on the phone getting an appointment. He's like, I've been holding off this surgery for so long. I'm like, oh, my God, I can't even imagine. It's like, he's been doing hardwood flooring his whole life. And he got into it because the money was good. He hates the job. He's really? Like, yeah.
Is he the owner?
Yep. And I'm one of his few employees. Right now, it's like him and his brother-in-law. So, you know, it's good for me for the time being, but I imagine starting that as a teenager, it's just like back-breaking, shoulder-breaking, knee-breaking. He's had both his knees replaced. Like, there's people out here who have done jobs that are terrible. And it sucks. I'm glad I did. I think manual labor teaches someone hard work.
Definitely.
There's no better teacher of hard work besides making someone work hard. Like, push something around
A
bit.
It's a teacher of hard work in the sense that, like, when you perform manual labor, it's a very, the result is very tangible. You know, you see exactly what you've accomplished when you're doing, like, landscaping or flooring or roofing.
Yeah,
the end goal is very present. It's a finite game in a way.
Yeah,
it's easy to see.
And that's why it teaches people.
It teaches you that. Yeah,
because then you figure out, okay, what I do actually matters, and then you can form the delayed gratification discipline to do things that you're not going to see a result from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You might not see the result like 10 to 15 to 20 years down the line. I know, like, my psilocybin like company isn't gonna be going in for like another like 10 years, but it's like I've been planning this out since I was like 18.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're building the foundation right now.
Literally. So I just, you know, you have to be able to put yourself in your place. And if you're not willing to put yourself in your place, God will put you in your place. It's happened to me so many times. That's why I stopped trying to go against my intuition. When your intuition tells you to do something, you got to do it. Speaking of...
Well, sometimes you have to think deeper about that. Like, I had something happen to me recently where I made a really quick decision. I was kind of, like, off a gut feeling, like I would just do this particular thing to get to this end result that I had been craving. I can't really say what it is, but I was, like, really hoping that if I just did this thing, it would get me that end result. And it totally led me astray. Potentially even prevented me from hitting that end result at all because I made such a quick decision in that way rather than taking time to digest it. And maybe I guess that is giving your intuition time to like develop. But I think a lot of people might interpret what you just said as like using your gut feeling. I think it's important in certain situations.
I think there's a difference between gut and intuition. I don't see them the same. Like, my intuition, like, is, like, I can feel it coming from, like, a higher consciousness versus from, like, me and, like, deep down. It's different from hearing something from deep down versus from hearing something from your highest self.
Mm.
The highest self is the one that's one with everything. That's, like, the infinite intelligence, the subconscious, versus the... your reptilian brain telling you to, like, yo, you got to do this now right. Or you're going to die. Like,
right. That, like, fight or flight, like, yep. Instinct brain.
Exactly. Versus. Yeah.
So that's kind of how I felt in that moment. Like, that took over my like, irrational yep. brain. Or, sorry, my rational brain kind of went away and, like, my impulsivity came out.
Uh huh.
And it just sort of tarnished, like, an opportunity.
I'm sure.
Make something better out of that situation.
Yeah, no, I've made those mistakes too. But the more you reflect on it, the more you'll realize that what happened was supposed to happen, and you just gotta play it into the script.
For sure, I guess you wouldn't realize it if it didn't happen.
Yeah, so. There was this song by Russ called Utah Freestyle, and he has a bar where he says, "When I stumble, I'm aware it's just part of the dance."
Mm.
And
speaking of dance, this is a little tangent. I was at work a couple weeks ago, and I just love this story because it was so fun. I was carrying like a bunch of metal pieces that go to the bar, like grates and shit like that, that, you know, fits in. We take them back to the kitchen to get washed. So I'm taking them back from the kitchen to the bar. I'm holding them in one arm. I'm turning the corner. As I'm turning the corner, I'm looking behind me, saying something to somebody. And I, like, come centimeters away from, like, demolishing this lady, like, almost walking right through her. But, like, we both, like, look up and, like grab each other and, like, save the collision and literally danced it off. Like, we spun around. And she's like, "Whoa, are you dancing with me?" And I was like,
"What?"
I was like, "Yeah, we can." And then started dancing. Like, it was actually so funny. This lady who's yes. like 50 and I just started dancing because we almost collided.
Yeah, that's ended so up awesome.
Going from like almost a tragic incident to like one of the funniest things that's happened to me in a long time.
Yeah, I'm so happy to hear that.
Because we just, you know, played it off and kept flowing.
Yo, literally, dude, that.
Could have been really bad. Like, I could have actually trampled this lady and, like, dropped metal plates on her.
Yo, you're also, like, not, like, a small dude. You're, like, something six something.
Yeah, I'm, like, fucking 6'3", 6'4". Like,
yeah.
Almost 200 pounds. Like, I would have trampled this lady.
Literally. I'm so glad you didn't.
But then I ended up seeing her. She came in for dinner, like, a week later. And I, like... knew I recognized her, but I couldn't figure out why.
Wait, so was this a customer?
Yeah. So
that's even better.
Customer, not a coworker. And then I'm like, I see this lady at the bar, and I'm like, oh, I think she looks familiar, but like, I don't really know why. So like, I didn't really talk to her because I couldn't remember why. But then like, right as she was about to leave, she was like, hey, you're that guy that danced with me. I was like, oh, that is so funny. She was like, do you want to dance again? I was like, yeah, I'll find you after work. And we'll go out and we'll dance. It'll be great.
Oh my God. That's so funny. That's so awesome.
Yeah, I'm not really much of a dancer, but. When the time's right.
When the time's right. Yo, same here, bro. Literally exact same.
Yeah.
Well, everyone, I think we're going to cut it about there.
Yeah, that was fun. Cheers.
Cheers. Time. So.
Thank you for having me on.
Of course. Besides, let me get this. Thank you. Besides your dancing story. Do you have any final words for these wonderful people?
Any final words?
On leadership.
On leadership. I mean, I think the biggest thing that I've been able to internalize, like, through my personal leadership studies, I suppose, is, like, really just giving up that power. Like, leadership isn't always about having power. It's about instilling it in the people you are working with.
Delegation
for sure. But like, just being able to inspire, and like, rather than to be nitpicky or like, you know, come down on people when they're doing something wrong, you know, have empathy for them and like, and build them up when they're doing the right things, and be able to talk to them when they're doing the wrong things in a positive way. So yeah, and I think that translates outside of leadership too, just being able to like have empathy for people, and understand that, like, you know, sometimes people do things that might bother you or make you feel bad, but, you know, ultimately they probably didn't mean it that way. I don't know. I think just having a more positive outlook and trying to uplift one another is the best you can do.
I agree with that. It full-heartedly.
It goes to leadership. It goes to living your day-to-day life, whatever you want to apply it to.
Yeah. Well, everyone, you heard the man. John, got anything you want to shout out? Anything cool coming up?
Anything I want to shout out? Well, this podcast is probably going to come out after the fact, but Friday night, October 11th, my friend Breno, Unitary Forever on Instagram, and myself are going to be releasing some one-of-one hockey jerseys. This is a project we've been working on for a couple years now, and so it's his clothing company is kind of like the basis of the design, but I help pick out the jerseys and make some designs within them. And each one is inspired after a particular NHL player who's had an impact on me, like mainly when I was a kid growing up watching hockey, and just players who impacted the game in a major way.
That's so awesome.
It's really cool. I'm super stoked about it. And yeah, check them out. We'll be selling them at Pumpkin Fest, and, you know, maybe there might be a few extra left over. So find us on Instagram, and yeah.
Yeah, guys.
Give a shout out to Nate. Shout out to my friends and family for being fucking dope. And yeah, thank you for having me on.
Of course. All right, everyone. Thank you all for listening. Focus on personal excellence. And the better you make yourself, the better you're going to make everyone around you, because you bleed into everyone that you come in contact with, whether you like it or not. So make sure you bleed positivity into them and not anything else. With that, my name is Nate Serentino. This was John Gaffney. And this was the Freethinkers Emergence Podcast. Peace. I can fly.